Okay, so let's talk about the number of weights and about the RNA Fisher vector dimensions. Because actually there is a problem here, because we know that the number of weights in the network is not small, and the number of weights would be exactly the length of this gradient. We don't want this gradient to be too big, because it will be hard to use it for the classification or whatever we would like to do. So what we observe is that the partial derivatives with respect to the weights of the LSTM layer did not contribute to the performance. So for this reason, we could just take the weights of the upper layer and reduce significantly the number of weights and the RNA Fisher vector size.
So you have only one layer of LSTM, yes?
The network stays the same, but when we take the gradient, we only use the gradient with respect to the weights of the upper layer.
You have few layers of LSTM or one?
One.
Okay.
But this LSTM has many weights because they have gates. Okay. For each gate, you have a multi.
Maybe also multi layers.
Yes.
Good.
Yeah, so you're right. Only one LSTM there. We further reduced the dimensionality using PCA. And we observed that it didn't affect the performance. So what was the size? So in the video case, we used LSTM layer of size 200, output layer of size 500. So number of weights is the multiplication. It's 100K. And with the PCA, the dimension reduction reduces to only 1K vector. It's a very convenient size. And in the sentence case, the optimal values were a bit different. LSTM layer of size 100, output layer of size 300, the size of the wall to back. So number of weights multiplication is strictly K, and we reduce it to 4K without affecting the performance.
Gradients.
PCA of the gradients. These gradients are the representation of our sequences.
Is there any advantage of having gradients instead of weights themselves as a representation of your sequence?
What people like to do to represent sequences is to take the last hidden state of the LSTM. Not the weight, but the
state.
Activation value, the state.
And so you have better performance.
Yeah, so
taking gradients.
Yeah, yeah,
okay.
We tested it, and the performance of the gradient is much better. It's richer. It's a higher dimensional.
But so if one would take just weights, it also will have rich.
But the weights of the network are constant. You train the network, and the weights are constant.
Okay, so it's the gradient. Trained network with respect to your data. Okay, good.
Another question?
Basic question. Visual vector is the gradient of the latitude and spectral parameters. At what point the gradient is computed? What parameter?
It depends of, you're talking about Fisher vector in general, or this Fisher vector with this RNN probabilistic model?
In general.
In general, you have a model, and you have a group of vectors, and you ask the model, what is the likelihood that the model gives to this set of vectors? So how to compute this likelihood, it depends on the model. For example, in the original Fisher vector, the model is GMM, and you have now a set of vectors. You want the likelihood of this set of vectors. So what is the likelihood given a GMM? You take the first vector. What is the likelihood? It would be the sum of the weights, Wi, or I call it a tau i, multiplied by the density of the i's Gaussian, right? This is the likelihood of one vector, right? So in case of GMM, you compute it this way, and the likelihood of the entire set of vectors, they just assume the independence, so they take the product.
I understand that. Mm-hmm. The gradient is the function so, so of short parameter point and parameter space of computer.
Before gradient, let's compute the likelihood, okay? And then after we compute the likelihood, we have to derive it to find the gradient. So in GMM, you can do it analytically. You can get the formulas by deriving by hand, and then you can compute it. Here, we use the we first compute the likelihood of the entire sequence, as we saw in the previous slide. And then, in order to compute the gradient, we just do backpropagation, because this is what backpropagation do. It computes the gradient of the loss of our model. And the loss of our model and the likelihood of the sequence are the same. This is what we saw, are the same up to a constant which will not affect the gradient. What is the gradient? For in the first timestamp, you free the x0, you get the loss, and we do. You're right. In the first timestamp, we do a backpropagation here, and we have a gradient for this wave. In the second timestamp, again, we feed it, we do backpropagation, and also backpropagation to here, and get gradients. And we do it for all timestamps, and we sum up those gradients to get one gradient. The update for the it's the update that we would do to the network if it was training. But here we are in test time. We will not use this gradient in order to update the network, we just use it as the representation of the sequence. It's important to notice it. We take gradient, but we are not in training time, we are in test time, we will not update the model with this gradient. We just use it as the representation of the sequence. What is the intuition for doing it? This gradient is the direction to update the model weights in order to have this sequence more probable. So intuitively, when two sequences are similar, so the weight update should be more or less the same. So I didn't mention it, but this is the intuition of why it would work well.
How sensitive is your Gaussian assumption in this refer your L2 prediction? There is a you assume that in order to get this nice formula, you assume this exactly this model.
Okay, so this actually, it's not an assumption. Actually, it's an interpretation. In order to have it, have this model, we look at this model as giving us probability or likelihood of the sequence. Actually, even if you use another loss function, you don't have to use this loss function. You can use other loss functions too. So you still can. You don't have to interpret it as likelihood. You can use another loss, which is not interpretable as a loss function, and you still can take this gradient, and the intuition behind it would be the same, how to update the model in order to have this sequence more likely. So it's not required to do this assumption or interpretation. You just it's nice to show it this way in order to be aligned with the Fisher vector, the original Fisher vector method of deriving the likelihood. But it's not necessary. You could just say, I'm taking the gradient of the loss of the model, and it would be valid as well. just a nice way of looking at it.
You just say that models with smaller loss are more probable, and that's your general statement.
Models with smaller loss are more probable?
Data which provides smaller loss is more probable.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so that we achieve the convenient size of the representation. Okay, so this is a summary of the video action recognition pipeline. So we get in the left the input video. It's a sequence of frames. Each frame we feed to a pre-trained network in order to achieve a vector representation for this frame. So in case of single frames, we use the VGG. In case of blocks of 16 frames, we use the 6VG. And as mentioned, in this case, we sampled the one frame of each 16. And we get vector representation for all the frames of this video. Here we have some post-processing, PCA, dimension reduction, L2 normalization. And then we do the pooling using the RNN feature vector. So as we saw, we feed it to the RNN, time step by step, take the break propagation, and have the vector representation of the video. Then we do another post-processing. As mentioned, we do a PCA. We also do L2 normalization. And then we feed it to a SVM classifier in order to get the prediction. So this is the entire pipeline for classification in the action recognition task.
Is SVM linear?
Yeah, it was linear.
So why the L2 normalization? Usually you'd like to scale all the elements in the vector using L1. So they have the exact same size, maximal size.
You're right. Often we scale the parameters. We have to ask Gil. It was conducted by Gil, so I guess empirically this is how we get the best results.
So why doesn't the
RNN
scale the RNN directly predicts the action?
So we tried it as a baseline, and it was worse than using this method. It was a baseline that should have been done, and we checked it. And a simple RNN which predicts the classification was not as good.
Do you have a reason why, or a guess?
The gradient representation is very rich. It's high dimensional, so maybe the network has no capacity, there's no enough capacity to represent the sequence over time and make as good a prediction as the RNN feature vector.
If you use SVM, in the end, then you can use a whole set of methods for kernels for SVM, for example, dynamic time alignment kernels, which are designed exactly for that.
Try
that?
No.
Because this is the most immediate thing to do if you use SVM.
Yeah. Actually, it would be interesting. It's an interesting experiment, but we didn't try. Okay, and move on to the image sentence retrieval task. So what is the pipeline in this case? So here we represent the sentence as the RNN feature vector. Here we focus on the sentence, this is the sequence. And the image, we just do a CNN feature extraction. Again, we use the VGG, extract the vector representation of size in 4K. And then we map the image and the sentences to a common vector space using the CCA, the canonical correlation analysis. So this algorithm gives you two matrices, one matrix for the sentence vector and another matrix for the image vector. So those representations don't have even to be in the same size, but these two matrices bring them to the same size and also to the same vector space with the property of now in the new common vector space, a correct pair of image and sentence would be closed in this space, closed in the L2 norm or cosine similarity. So we use the CCA to bring it to a common semantic vector space. And then how we do with the prediction, given an image, we map it, we represent as using VGG as a vector. Then we map it using the CCA matrix to the common vector space. And the same for the sentences. We represent each sentence with the RNN Fisher vector. Then we use the second CCA matrix to map them to the common vector space. And we take the nearest name. Or actually, we score all the sentences according to the cosine similarity with the image. Okay, here are the results, the performance in the video action recognition task. So we can see that we achieved the state-of-the-art results in two data sets, one with 51 classes, the other one with 101 classes. Actually, in the ECCB, there was another work which got a bit better results, but need to remember that their work or their method was tailored specifically to this task, and the RNN Fisher vector is a general method for any sequence. So this is an advantage of our method. Here we can see a comparison between RNN Fisher vector and the GMM Fisher vector, the traditional. So for each data set, we can see that for each element representation, we see a consistently that RNN Fisher vector performs better. So it was interesting in the nice to see. Here is the performance of RNN Fisher vector in the other task, in the image sentence retrieval. So here we see results on two data sets, Flickr 2K and Flickr 3K. And in the paper, we also show results on a couple. So these are the recorded one results. Again, you see that we got good results. We got In this measure of recorded one, we got the state-of-the-art result, we got the best result. Actually, in the paper, we show, in addition to recorded one, we show recorded 5 and recorded 10 from 3 data sets. So we are not the best in each and every measure, but we are competitive in all of these measures. So it's nice to see that this method works well on two different tasks, different domains. Also, a nice observation was we tried to model the RNN on external corpus, on sentences from Wikipedia, not on the sentences of the specific data set, the sentences of those data sets. And still, we see a good performance. This is the Wikipedia trained RNN. We still see not the best, but good performance, which is very nice. It demonstrates the generalization capability.
This is the accuracy or error rate, I guess?
This is a recall.
Oh, recall, right, sorry.
Yeah, so it's nice to see that you can train your RNN on external data. In case of text, just take, for example, sentences from Wikipedia, and then you can use it in your specific data, and
we observed good results when doing it. Okay, and there is further work. There is a recent paper of Dotan Kaufman, Guy Levy, Tal Hassler, and Professor Leo Bond, in which they used the RNN Fisher vector as well. The paper is called Temporal Distillation for Vinon Tension and Summarization. So this is a very recent paper. It's under submission. It's available on the archive. So they used it on several benchmarks of video annotation and the video summarization, and achieved state-of-the-art results using the RNN Fisher vector presentation for video. For example, these are results for the LSMDC. It's a large-scale movie description challenge. So this challenge is pretty similar to image text retrieval. Here we have a large set of short video clips, and each video clip is associated with a sentence describing it. It's interesting how the data was collected. They used a set of movies and the audio descriptions, which are prepared for visually impaired. So these audio descriptions are combined with the soundtrack of the movie, and it helps the visually impaired. So what they did, they took the this audio description and they applied the speech to text method. And this is how they obtained the text, and they split it according to the time intervals and created a large data set. And the task is retrievable. Given a video and a set of all sentences in the test set, you have to retrieve the correct sentence or a good sentence to represent the video. And it was nice to see that they got best results, better than very strong groups from Berkeley, Montreal. This measure is the way of operation was to give the human judges the predicted sentence of the model and a reference description written by the human being, and the judge should decide which is better. And this is the percentage of times that the model won. The sentence predicted by the model, the judge thought that the sentence is better. So, so it's another work that achieved the state of the art result with the RNN Fisher vector. Okay, thank you very much. Any questions?
I have something. If you don't understand something. The VGG is a classification. The classification network, right? So it actually gives you the, like when it looks at an image, gives you the probability to have each one of the categories irrespective of their location. Mm-hmm. Okay, so when you have a sequence of images from the same images from the same video, and the video supposedly contain the same object, so it should give just a constant vector all the time.
But you don't take the final you don't take the soft data of the source mass. You okay. Take a layer before.
A layer before, okay, but still a layer before is also a kind of representative of the objects. It should be dense, for example, in clusters corresponding in locations corresponding to the categories, no?
That's the embedding. This is a form of embedding of a picture.
No, it's just the last layer is just linear. Okay? So this is just the inverse of this linear layer. So it's the same thing. Okay.
Which layer is it? You mean the
soft marks, yes.
Yeah, but you're right that the